All right. Let's say I have the correct measurements for this triangle. Right? And I plug them into that formula, then I should be able to get the third leg, and that's going to be correct every time, right? What happens if I have the correct measurements, but I don't like that formula, and I want to change it? It's what it's a squared plus b squared equals c squared, is that right? What if I don't like squares? What if I just want to say a plus b equals c?
It won't work.
It won't work? What if I like cubing things, and I want to say a cubed plus b cubed equals c jubed? Cubed, I mean. Okay, she didn't get it. That's Jubilee. I call her the Jubes. All right. Here's my point. You're going to find in our scripture today, Jesus said, if your eye is good, then your body will be full of light. If your eye is bad, your body will be full of darkness. He said, if the light that is in you is darkness, how great is the darkness? If you got the right formula, all you need to do is seek the correct measurements and you're going to get the correct answer. But if you have the wrong formula, it doesn't matter how accurate you are. You're going to get it wrong every single time. It's absolutely imperative that the light that is in you, which is the basis for right and wrong, be right. Or nothing that you believe is right will be right. And nothing that you believe is wrong will be truly wrong. Think about that. We're going to get back to it. I thought that in conjunction with what we're going to be studying this evening, with what Jesus had to say, that we would look at the moral argument for God's existence. And this is the way William Lane Craig lays it out for you. It goes something like this. If God does not exist, then objective moral duties and values do not exist. Let's define our terms here first, okay? Objective means outside of you. It's not contingent upon, dependent upon how you feel or what you think of it. In other words, there is in fact an open Bible on this desk. Now, you may have an opinion about the Bible. You may think it's God's word or you may think it's a fairy tale, but that's absolutely irrelevant. All I'm telling you is there is an open Bible on this desk. Actually, this isn't even a desk. It's a table, okay? But nonetheless, that's an objective reality. It is outside of you. It is outside of me. It is measurable. It is provable. That's what objective means. Subjective would be my opinion of that, my feeling about that, beliefs that I have developed surrounding that. For instance, when I say that I believe the Bible is God's word, that is subjective. Now, I can appeal to some objective facts that will back that up. Nonetheless, the objective reality that I'm pointing to here is there is an open Bible here. That's what objective means. A moral value means what is good or what is bad. What is good or what is evil. The example that William Lane Craig gives between moral values and moral duties is this. In his book, Reasonable Faith, he said, it could be considered and should be considered good that someone would want to be, actually he says it this way, it would be good for someone to be a chemist. A chemist is good. It is an occupation that contributes a great deal to science. It contributes a great deal to our world. But that doesn't mean that everybody ought to be one. Does that make sense? The ought part, you ought to do that, is the right and wrong. So what we're talking about, the good or bad, the good or evil, that is the moral value. The ought is the right or wrong. You ought to do it or you ought not to do it. Now let's go back to the second premise of our argument. If God does not exist, then moral values, moral values and duties do not exist. Objective moral values and duties do exist, therefore God exists. Now, there are a lot of there's a lot of argumentation that goes on concerning this particular argument. A lot of debate that goes that surrounds this. But here is what William Lane Craig presents, and I think it's very valuable for us to lay hold of. If there is no God, there's no way for us to objectively state that there is a moral good or a moral duty that is incumbent upon every single person to observe, right? Let's look at several. One of the reasons I wanted to get rid of the kids. If we were to think about something as horrific as rape or child abuse or murder, wouldn't we all agree that those three things are evil? Those three things are bad? Therefore, wouldn't each and every one of us agree that all three of those would be things that we should not do? It is incumbent upon us not to participate in any of those activities. All right? So what we're saying is that those are objective evils, and to not do those things represents objective wrong. That means it is objective, it is outside of what you and I think. Now, somebody could be a sociopath. They could have no real sense, no good conscience, no sense of right and wrong, and they might participate in some of those things and think they're okay. Somebody could struggle with schizophrenia and laugh at their mother's funeral. We wouldn't think that that's normal. However, if we have no objective basis for morality, then what the schizophrenic does at his mother's funeral, what, you know, this evil person does to a child or a woman or an animal, cannot be categorically stated as objectively wrong. I can say, well, I feel it's wrong. I can say, well, our society considers it wrong, but it cannot be objectively considered wrong. So as a result, William Lane Craig appeals to this idea that God is the root or the ground of moral values and moral duties, okay? So I wanted to present that as a rational argument. I want you to take a look at this or think about this as it has an impact on you. Since God exists, since God is good, and since God's will determines right and wrong, then you must make God your highest value, and you must discover and do God's will. Now you understand why the Bible says, the fool has said in his heart, there is no God, they are corrupt, their deeds are vile. I don't want anybody to tell me what to do. But if I understand the previous argument, which is pretty clear, pretty straightforward, that without God, there's no objective morality, there's no objective value, there's no objective duty, much less a universal moral code of ethics, then I have some real trouble trying to negotiate this life and to determine what is right and what is wrong, other than what I feel is right and what I feel is wrong. But the moment I capitulate to the weight of that argument, then I am placed in the position where I look at these suppositions and they are going to be authoritative over me, because God does exist. And God is good. Therefore, I have to understand God to understand what is good. And I need to understand God's will to understand what is right and what is wrong. So I've titled this message, Your Values Determine Your Vision. And we get back to what Jesus said. And I will go ahead and read this from the English Standard Version once again. I'm going to back up to the last verse from last week and then progress ahead, because this all relates. Jesus said, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you is darkness, how great is the darkness?" Let's look at Jesus' illustration here. I wear glasses. I wear glasses because I'm myopic. If I take my glasses off, you all look like an impressionist painting, all right? a Monet or a Manet. The Impressionists who painted during the 19th century and arose in France are so named because they didn't paint photorealistic scenes. They painted a style that represented how they felt about that scene, how it came across to them. But, you know, it's interesting that the hypothesis has been that all of these men, as they grew older, had eyesight that grew weaker, which almost everyone's eyesight grows weaker as you grow older, and especially if you go through a round of college where you're looking at numbers very closely and studying, or you're looking reading a lot of books, it makes you more nearsighted, all right? So I can get up on this Bible, and right here is the perfect distance for me. Like, I can read this really clearly right here, but if it gets too close, I can't read it. And if it gets even that far away, it's blurry. And beyond that, you all are blurry. I have to have corrective lenses so that I can see properly. Now, we're filming this tonight. I've been filming these and putting them on YouTube so that other people can watch them. And when I have done either photography or when I've done videography in the past, if I am going to try to focus that camera myself, manually focus that camera, I either need to be wearing my glasses, or if I'm looking through the lens, the viewfinder, then I have to take off my glasses and I have to use a little device called the diopter. How many of you have ever heard of a diopter before? All right. Well, the diopter is an adjustment that allows you to adjust that viewfinder to your particular eyesight. In order for me to properly adjust the diopter, then I have to be in focus to begin with. Does that make sense? Because I've got to be able to focus inside this viewfinder so that each time now I focus the lens, I'm going to be able to see what is actually out there. Otherwise, if I were to try to focus manually based on my vision problem, everything would be blurry. Or at the very least, it would be soft focus. I don't know if you have watched a lot of documentaries recently, but a lot of documentaries, the documentarian doesn't seem to care so much about focus. I was watching Exit, what's it called? Exit Through the Gift Shop or something like that. Is that the name of the film? Somebody exit through the gift shop. I didn't even know it was about that. It was about all of these street artists, right? Very, very interesting. But the guy that's doing all the videography, he's filming all these street artists. If you've ever seen the T-shirts that say Obey and have the, you know, funky-looking face on there, that really comes from a Los Angeles street artist that was putting that face, which is an impression, by the way, of Andre the Giant, all over Los Angeles. Well, there's this little Frenchman who runs around filming these guys, and initially he was telling them that he was creating a documentary on them, and the reality was he was just an obsessive, compulsive videographer. He just wanted to film everything. Like, he couldn't stay at home. He would pick up his camera and he would pick up a huge case of tapes, because this is back when everything was on tape and not on card like we do now. And he would just go around and film everything and film everything and film everything. And he ran into these street artists and they introduced him to other street artists. And pretty soon he's filming all of these secretive street artists that are out there creating, you know, this what we call it, street art. It's graffiti is what it is. And they, you know, they could get in some serious trouble for doing what they were doing. And some of them did. Like, he filmed some of them getting arrested. All right. But it's very, very interesting, but the majority of his stuff is soft focus. It just drove me nuts watching this thing. I'm like, come on, dude. It drives me nuts when I am filming something and it's soft focus. I just can't stand it. I want it to be in focus. Well, that's predicated on a truth, that there is a true focus, right? That it's not just all about my impression. Now, I may have a reason for something to be out of focus. I may want to give you an impression. I may want you to be struggling as you're looking at that, because I want to say something with that in my narrative style of filmmaking, okay? But nonetheless, typically, you want your camera to be in focus when you shoot a scene. And in order for that to happen, for me in any event, there has to be a lens correction. So I'm wondering, let's look at each of our spiritual vision, our moral vision tonight. Do you need correction in order to be able to see clearly? All right? Right and wrong. Right and wrong is a universal reality. These are universal realities. The Creator determines right on the basis of His own good nature. Now, let me stop there. There is a dilemma that is often presented to people who would put forth this moral argument. And the dilemma goes all the way back to Plato. I'm sure, Robert, you're familiar with the Euthyphro dilemma, right? And it goes something like this. If God is the ground or the basis for morality, then God either decides what is right because it's right, or He makes it right because He's God. If He decides what is right, or if He follows what is right because it's right, then right is actually over God. Right has authority over God. But if God simply decides what is right or what is wrong on the basis of what He wants, then it would seem that that would be capricious. In other words, on the second assumption, God could call injustice justice, and we would all think that that was justice. He could call dark light and light darkness, and then we would have to assume that that was the reality. But the solution to the Euthyphro dilemma is this. God determines what is right and wrong after the counsel of His own will, and His will is determined or decided by His own good nature. Listen, God is good. God is love. God is just. Those things are integral to His character. Those things are integral to His nature. The reason good is good is because God is good. The reason right is because God wills it so in accordance with His good nature. That's the resolution to that, by the way. Everyone has a conscience to discern right from wrong. Call your conscience your moral vision, if you will. The right and wrong of your conscience are determined by what you believe to be good. Your conscience may be good or bad, or we could say healthy or sick, depending upon what you've chosen to accept as good. The Proverbs have it this way: there is a way that seems right to a man, but in the end it leads to death. So you may say, I believe that this is right. I don't care what you say. I just feel that this is right. But if it's not right, if it is not grounded in God's good nature, and God is the only natively immortal, everlasting, always existing being, then what you believe as good will eventually be done away with. Only God is good. Only God is immortal. Only what God says and what God thinks and what God wills will continue to exist. He's the ground of all being. He is the ground of all existence. So if I want to line up what is truly good in me, and I want that to last, I need to line that up with who God is. That's why we learned when we were looking at the model prayer that Jesus led us to say, "Your kingdom come, Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Not my will be done, but Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." That's the prayer we need to be pursuing all the time. So the eye is the lamp of the body. If your eye is healthy, your body will be full of light. If your eye is bad, your body will be full of darkness. If then the light that is in you is darkness, how great is the darkness? Well, if God is in you, there will be no darkness in you. 1 John 1:5 says, God is what? Light. And in Him there is no darkness at all. So I want you to come follow me into this pattern here, if you will. Okay? Value, vision, practice. You value what you believe is good. All right? Your goods, your highest goods, will represent your highest values. That's what you're going to place at the top of your hierarchy of significance. You pursue what you value. You chase what you value. All right? Therefore, your personal habits and practices are determined by what you see as good. You're going to do what you do on the basis of what you follow. And you're going to follow what you truly think for you is good. So it's imperative that what for you is good lines up with what is objectively good, and that is what is in God. All right? And I say it this way. If your right is wrong, you can do no right. If your right is wrong, then you're never going to be doing anything right. Think about how people's values have changed in our culture and in our society, and how that has changed behavior. How many school shootings have there been? People value personal freedom. People value their guns. We have children that are being raised on violence and so forth. There's no easy answer to these things, but certainly people's sense of right and wrong has changed. People's sense of what is good and what is evil has changed. And when you get into the minds of some of these individuals, whether they're school shooters or serial killers or whatnot, I mean, there's a real tendency to want to just experiment, to want to see what it feels like to kill somebody. I can't tell you how many times I've heard this recently when it concerns the motive behind a young person killing someone. Well, I just wanted to know what it felt like. Apparently, the young man who shot the 7-Eleven store clerk just a few months ago, who, by the way, was a young person that at one point in time had visited Next Step, and Craig had actually taken this kid home. What was his name? Do you remember his name, Craig? If you remember it in a minute, tell me what his name was. But you posted his picture. But this was the young man that walked in with his dad's rifle and shot the store clerk just because he wanted to see what it felt like. He wanted to know what it felt like. That was the statement that was made by the two young men that beat, I believe it was a soccer player to death who was jogging. You know, I just wanted to see what it felt like. I just wanted to know what it felt like. I was reading a book about the Columbine school shooting recently, and this particular author went in depth into the backgrounds of Dylan Klebold and Eric Harris. And, you know, these guys were just, in many respects, amoral. I mean, they just spoke of other people as though those other people were nothing more than things, you know, like a chair. If I want to tear up a chair, I tear up a chair. If I want to shoot somebody in the head, then I shoot somebody in the head. Well, this is obviously somebody whose highest good is not good any longer, okay? Now, we wonder why this is, okay? But it is because we have been brought to the place where we believe that morality is subjective. What you believe is right for you. If that's wrong, that's wrong for you. And what is right for me is right for me. Well, on that basis, how can I say that what Eric Harris and Dylan Klebold did was objectively wrong? I can't. Because it was right for them, right? It was good for them. Right? They wanted to blow up the whole school. I don't know if you're aware of that. But they set bombs all over that school. And in fact, they went marching in with their guns earlier than they had anticipated because they thought that all these bombs that they set up were going to be blowing up the school as they marched in there. All right? So there's a whole lot wrong today, and it has to do with this vision that we have lost. All right? Now, those of us in this room, I believe, the majority of you in this room would probably say that you want to do what is right, that you do believe that there's an objective moral good out there. Maybe we would disagree as to what every one of those moral goods are, but probably most of us, many of us, would agree that there is that out there, all right? It is in the details. The devil is in the details, as they say, all right? If I'm going to line up with the weight of the truth, which is that there is a God who does exist, who is good, and who wills what is right and what is wrong on the basis of his own character and his own nature. But then I look at myself and I see that there are plenty of areas in my life where I don't will the same good as God or the same right as God, where I don't necessarily agree, at least when I look at my life with God. Then we might say that you and I are plagued with double vision. Let's look at what Jesus said to continue here. He said, "No one can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. So in this case, Jesus used money or wealth. The term there is actually mammon, and it was a word that would be translated wealth, but it was a word that represented a deity of wealth, deifying money, deifying wealth. Well, the truth is, I'm not going to really talk about money so much. A lot of what we spoke of last week, which wasn't really about money, was also about this idea of not serving two masters, of not setting up an idol in your heart, okay? But I want to bring out this reality. You do have a sense of right and wrong in you because you have a conscience. God has given every single person a conscience. Now, you can scar that conscience. You can damage that conscience. You can overwrite that conscience with new content, but you do have a conscience, and your conscience is going to convict you of what is right and what is wrong. But if you want your conscience to be accurate, then you need your conscience to be completely committed to the Lord Jesus Christ, who is God's perfect expression of truth, truth as a person. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." So the law was an expression of God's truth, but Jesus is the personal expression of God's truth. So if I want to understand what is really true, I don't just read words in a book. I let those words lead me to a person, and I begin to understand who that person is and what that person is like. That gives me an accurate understanding of the truth, and then I follow the truth, and that enlightens my whole body. But if I'm divided, because I want to do this, but I believe that God is leading me away from this, the Bible teaches that I shouldn't do this, then I am going to be perpetually split. I'm going to have double vision, and I'm going to have problems with that double vision. What did Bob Dylan say? He said, "You got to serve somebody." It's an old song. All right. I don't know if you ever heard that song or not. He said, "You got to serve somebody." He said, "It might be the devil or it might be the Lord, but you got to serve somebody." You're going to bow down and worship someone or something, even if that's you, your image, your will, yourself. But as long as I'm divided, I'm never going to receive all that God wants to give me. In James chapter 1, James said that if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, and he won't rebuke you for asking him. But he said, don't ask with a double mind. He said, the double-minded person is unstable in all of his ways. I need to be wholeheartedly committed to pursuing the wisdom that God reveals to me. And let me say this. The Bible is very clear in Proverbs that were written by the person that the Bible considers to be the wisest man that ever lived, Solomon. He did some unwise things, but he was a very wise man on the whole, all right? And that writer of the Proverbs said, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge." He said, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding." So what I need to begin with is that reverence, that utter and complete respect for God and who He is. And then I need to seek Him. I need to seek Him with all of my heart. And the Bible promises that if you seek Him, you will find Him if you seek Him with all of your heart. And the Bible promises, Jesus said, "Seek and you will find." He said, to begin with, "Ask and you will receive." Then seek and you will find. Then knock and the door will be opened to you. So I don't know where you are tonight. Many times we assume or presume that everybody sitting in a church service is there because they're already a Christian. You know, we might assume, well, maybe the visitor of so-and-so isn't, but everybody is. But I've come to see, especially after these interviews that Craig and I have done and Moses has helped us do, that there are plenty of people sitting in churches that are going through that process of doubt. And I never discourage doubt. I don't think that doubt is your enemy. I think presumption is your enemy. I think unthinking presumption is the real enemy. apathy is the enemy. Not caring, not being concerned about it, just kind of going along with the crowd. This is why so many people are switching over to atheism today, because the culture has moved that way. They were Christians before because the culture was Christian. Now the culture's not, so they're not. My friends, that's not real. What we want to find is we want to find the truth, all right? And there is truth, and it is out there. And I'm going to be able to discover that truth as I continue to seek this person, Jesus Christ, who claimed to be the embodiment of truth. So tonight, how are your eyes? Can you see pretty well? Is your vision double? You say one thing is right and one thing is good, but you do another thing last week, and that is dump the idols. Seek God wholeheartedly, and if you come to the place where you're able to exercise even a tiny little bit of faith, then I encourage you to throw your whole weight behind that. Trust God and pursue Him, and everything is going to become clear for you. The introduction to God is Jesus Christ, His Son. And the way that we gain access to the Father is through the grace that is given to us by the Son. The Bible says that if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart you believe and you're made righteous, with the mouth you confess and so are saved. Whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. Saved from a godless world, saved from a despairing world, saved from a damned world, saved for eternity with God in heaven. If that's what you want tonight, pray with me. Say something like this: God, I believe in You. Jesus, I believe You are God's Son. I believe You died on the cross. I believe You rose from the dead. I open my heart. I invite You to come inside. Take my life. I belong to You. In Your name I pray, Jesus. Amen. If you've made that start, then you put on your glasses. Better yet, you've gotten LASIK. And you're going to have some 20/20. All right? If you-